with a detour through Mr. B's ballroom, the Isley Brothers with Work to Do, and Tom Waits from Small Change, I Can't Wait to Get Off Work. That's it for me, Dirk Richardson. It's midnight. If you pledged tonight, thank you very much. If you didn't, I hope you will in the coming days here in the KPFA Winter Fun Drive. You are tuned to 94.1 FM KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 FM KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 FM KFCF in Fresno, and online where you can pledge securely and choose a thank you gift of your choice from a wide range of premiums, kpfa.org. It's time for Over the Edge.
good. Hello, it's Over the Edge. I'm Izzy Isn't. And tonight, we are 5 hours long. And the Booper's back. The Booper's back. And so are the repeating CDs. Yeah, the weatherman fixed my Booper, and I believe he's on the line right now. Let's see. Wait a minute. Hello. Well, whoever it was hung up. I don't know. Now the phone's... I can't get the phone on the air. Oh, great. Because he's supposed to call me at the beginning of the show, and I have some questions about the Booper. Now he's going to what? Give up? Everything's right, but the phone is not on the air. Try me again. Try me again.
Be loving me some Booper, dog. You know how it is.
You aren't the weatherman.
No, man. It's kind of distorted here from what I'm hearing. Oh, there you go. That's good. That's all hit. That's what we call things. That we like things like that are good. We call it all hit, like in the black community.
I bet that's not the weatherman either. Hey, weatherman, I'm getting calls on now, so give me a try.
Well, I am also not the weatherman. I was wondering if, though he does come on the air, does he remember his discussion about working for Contra Costa County? Talking about the bus driver seats do hiss, and he talked about, of course, you're in limbo, and you know who you are. Anyway, those were the 90s Over the Edge episodes, and those were probably some of the best. I wanted to know if he remembers any of that stuff.
Let's see if the phones work from this end.
Yeah, everybody's on, but now the weatherman is not calling.
Well, he's either calling or maybe he's on hold at this moment at one of the other flashing buttons.
No,
I will relinquish my place and let him...
You're the only button lit.
Oh, well, he's not calling at this moment.
That's right.
The instant another button lights up, tell me, and I will instantly relinquish... Boy, I hate that. I got to echo this time. You know, it happens sometimes and it happens not other times. Anyway, that was a launch from Vandenberg, if anybody's got clear eyes, clear skies to see it around 6 a.m. But I don't know what the weather's like up there, speaking of the weatherman.
It's not for a change.
You got clear skies?
Yeah, I wouldn't call them clear.
Boy, the fidelity of the phone really is...
All right, there's a flashing button. I got to go to that.
You're over amped on the phone. I can't hear you and what you're saying.
Can you hear me?
I cannot clearly hear you because you're spiking up to the ceiling with whatever it is you're using to speak through.
How's this? A little better?
Yes.
All right. I gotta go to this other button.
Bye.
Not the weatherman. Weatherman, we had this all worked out. You promised. You're gonna call me within the first 2 seconds of the show. Now what is happening? Are you listening? Where are you? What are you doing? Well, I had some questions for him about the booper. And, geez. There's no sound at all from... Oh, there it is. There, no, that's just... Oh, it's so confusing here. So confusing. Why aren't you calling, Weatherman? I...
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, just okay. I can hear you now.
Okay, I had trouble trying to get a good signal on the internet. I actually was calling while you were starting the show, but you didn't pick up.
I know you were the first call, and then by the time I got my setup here going correctly, you had hung up.
You're very loud and distorted. Is there any way you can turn yourself down a little bit?
Turn myself down, all right. How's that? Say that again. Is that a little better?
Yeah, it's a lot better. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, Booper, first of all, thank you. Thank you for fixing it. I'm glad to have it.
All right. Well, I need to tell you, you need to be extremely careful.
I am.
All right, the main thing, are you listening to me?
Yes, I am.
Very carefully now. You keep that background down while I'm talking.
It is.
Okay. The battery pack, the battery holder is not very strong.
Yeah.
Do you get that? The battery holder is not very strong.
Right.
So you need to be very careful when you replace batteries.
Well, the first thing I want to ask you is, how do I get it started? It's absolutely silent. I'm turning all the knobs, and I'm getting nothing.
All right. First of all, before you even try it, how do you have it connected?
I have it connected to my mixer.
Okay, and you know the mixer is going in okay, just as it always does.
Yes, I got it a couple of times here for a second or two, but now it's completely dead. I'm trying to start it up, make any noise at all. And it's not making any noise at all.
Okay, now, that's not good, because that means something may have happened to it already while it came back to you, as it was perfect.
No. I tried it at home, and I said, I just got a little bit of it here going, and then I stopped when you hung up, and then it won't start again.
All right, have you got it in the regular tape out? You can run it on the speaker out, but it'll be very loud. You might want to try that to see if it's very loud. You have to turn your gain down on the mixer if you switch plugs.
All right, first of all, imagine this, Weatherman. The booper is sitting in front of you horizontally. The battery package is on the right-hand side, okay?
All right, usually when
so,
I have
I'm trying to...
But I can see that. So though you got the battery pack on the right side.
Yes, and so right next to that is the on-off switch, and then there's a big knob, and then across from that is the red punch button. And then there's four knobs across the bottom, and that's it. Now, the thing is, I can't get any noise out of it to show you. But, for one thing,
What happened?
The far left knob on the bottom row. Remember how you're looking at it now.
You know what you're going to have to do? I'm going to have to turn on my computer and look at that picture because you're confusing me. So you're going to have to give me a moment while I get my picture of it on the screen. Can you do that?
Yeah, go ahead. We have nothing but wastable time.
All right. Well, it sounds like you got a nice drone going in the background there.
Yeah.
You'll just have to give me a about 2 minutes for this computer to settle in, and I'm going to get what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to the final picture that I took of the unit before I put it into the box.
Okay.
So you're going to have to just stand by for a minute.
Okay, I'm standing by.
What is that sound you have going in the background? I almost kind of recognize that sound.
That one, that's just a CD.
Is that my... That's like the stuff I recorded the hydrophone off the Pacific Coast.
That's the one. That's the one.
I recognize that. It's on the phone. And one thing that's happening that's very bad on the phone here, my voice is coming back at me an instant after I talk. So I don't know why it's doing that.
That's what Suicide Man says. He gets an echo, but other callers don't.
Yeah.
Other callers don't. I don't know why this is.
Yeah, my own voice is coming back at me, and it's now that I know that, I'll know to expect it.
Wow, okay.
Actually, when you kind of talk over it, it cuts off that echo that I have coming back at me. So the computer's just about on. I'll have it in just a moment because I want to orient the booper the same way that you have it so I can tell you exactly what to do.
Yeah.
How do you like those? How do you like it as far as the strength goes and the rigidity of the cabinet? It's not going to push through anymore.
Yeah, that's good. It's much better.
Well, I hope you aren't too heavy-handed because it isn't that strong. It's still pretty fragile because you might remind our listeners that that's been there for over 30 years. They do realize that, don't they? And I hope you do, too.
I don't know. Some do, some don't. Yes, this was invented by the weatherman. The weatherman invented the booper about 35 years ago.
In the middle 1970s, I pretty much had it in that box. And then just around the time that the group started, I kind of perfected it to the way it is now. But, you know, I hope to have it didn't get damaged to getting sent back.
There it is. So there it is.
Now I've got the computer on. I'm going to find that picture. So just... I'm going to go silent for a minute, and I'm going to get that picture of the booper on the screen.
I've already got it working.
That's good. I'm still going to put it on the screen, because this will help us. So bear with me for just a moment here. I'm going on to my other hard drive. In fact, this is going to be a big post. I'm going to post all about this on my next thing on Dumb. So everybody... Probably in the next week, I'll have it ready to go. Oh, I like that. I like that you've got something. Okay, here's the thing. Final look before giving it back to Tom. Okay. Now, I'm looking at it. Let's talk about it again. I'm going to make this picture even bigger. Let's see here. Zoom in. All right.
All right. Now, okay.
Can you hear me now? Because I've got the picture on the screen.
Yes. Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Could you turn it off, please? Press the red button to the off position. Now, is the battery pack on the right, and is the red button right just to the left of the battery pack?
That's right.
All right. Now, the knob that's just on the other side of the red button is the what we call the tape out or line level knob. So are you on line level and are you able to control the volume with that knob? Beat it up and down.
Yes. Yes, it does.
All right. That's good. Now that we've got it going, I'd like you to turn the red switch off. That's pushing it out, off. And when you do that, I'd like you to press the red button and see if you can momentarily make it oscillate. Okay, and then let's go. Now, I don't know if that's very useful. You know, I have to admit, I installed that red button mainly for looks. It looks great, doesn't it?
Yes.
But that's all it does. You can momentarily activate it by pressing it when the red switch is off.
Right. I don't know how that's... I haven't fooled with it enough to figure out how that's going
to
work.
It might be good to use to accent on callers or something, or when you have a good sound going, then you turn the red switch off, and then it'll turn on briefly while you're holding the red button. So, now... The bottom row of knobs on the right, all the way to the right, is the little knob. That's a pretty important knob. That controls the gain of the amplifier. So that one, when it's all the way counterclockwise, a lot of the sounds will go away. If you start turning that small knob on the bottom right, up one third and beyond, it starts to oscillate more.
Okay, yeah.
And then pretty much, I noticed you put little marks on the aluminum. Pretty much that holds true, but I think you'll notice the controls are smoother. I used a potentiometer cleaner on all the controls. How do you like that? It's starting to look good, isn't it?
Well,
I like that.
I like it too, but I'll tell you the truth. It's pretty different than what it was.
Oh yeah, it would be, because the dirty controls had their own character. I kind of given it a different character. As the battery gets weak and as those controls age again, it'll probably come back to that other character.
Okay, yeah. Look, what I would say is that before it was grungier, like in transitions going from one sound to another.
You can still get that grunge if you're right with the controls, because the way the booper works, it has so much gain. You can get it into white noise. You can actually turn the gain up if the controls are right, where it's hissing like noise on an FM radio and no station is tuned in, and then it'll suddenly start going into oscillating. So you've got to be very, very careful with the controls. And the reason that the controls are that way, I had to use high values of resistance, so all the action of the change is at one extreme or another extreme. You probably noticed, like, the second control, I'm looking at it now, you've got little marks all the way on one side where the action is, and that's still true, but it's smoother. I notice there's also a mark by the little knob all the way on the left side there, kind of like two-thirds of the way up. Those little marks that you put there, if I didn't erase them all, are still pretty valid. How do you like what I put? You have those little stickers on, and I filled them with little nuts and bolts.
What?
Controls that I used to have on it that I removed, you have those stickers, and I put bolts through the holes. I think that's a little nicer, don't you think?
Yes, right.
Now, have you ever wondered what that RCA jack is on top of the booper by the tape-out control? In between the tape-out and that Phillips head screw.
It's to put an input in that will be affected by the booper.
And it does work. On my post that I'm going to put up on Dumb in the next week or so, you'll see that in action. You can actually, if you have a cheap microphone like a Sony F98, for example, which you'll see in my video coming up, you can actually run it into feedback, and the feedback kind of controls the booper. And also, in addition, if you had a small speaker with a quarter-inch plug on a cord on a small speaker, you could plug it into the other output on the side, and you'd get not real loud, but sound, and that'll control the character of the booper still further.
All right, wait a minute.
If you've got any of that stuff, you can try that sometime.
Wait a minute.
And it will change it.
Can you hear me when I talk? When I talk, you just keep talking over me. Can you hear me okay?
That's because I guess the compressor is keeping it from happening, so go ahead.
Well, you know the two output jacks on the end of the booper? There's a left and the right. The right is the main one out, right?
One of them, since I'm not looking at it, I can't tell you which one it is, but obviously the one in, that you're using in the mixer is for the on the control. But the other one is a higher power output, and it'll run a small speaker. And if you put a speaker on that, it'll change the character of the blooper.
Okay, so I guess I have the right output.
If you're controlling it by that control that says tape out, you have the right one.
Yeah, right.
You could conceivably plug that quarter-inch plug into the other one. If you did, it'd be a fixed level, very loud. So if you ever want to try that, turn your input gain on your mixer all the way down before you try it.
You know, one thing is, it's not as boopy as it used to be. It's also solid tones like this. And I can move it around and find some variation, but it's all pretty solid tones. It doesn't get into these regions where
it sounds like you've got a big pink knob on the bottom right. If you've got that one all the way to one side or another, it'll tend to do that even more. So move that off a little bit.
Yeah, I am.
Okay, now move over to the white control and turn it all the way extreme and then back off a little bit. It should get more. Keep going. Now, immediately go all the way to the other. Turn up the little control on the far left. Turn it up to at least halfway.
Yeah.
Okay, now come to the second control, the big brown one,
yeah,
in between the white one and the little one. Turn it all the way to where your marks are. That's probably a pretty good spot.
Now, I'm going all the way around. It doesn't seem to get out of the sort of steady tone mode.
All right, leave it right there. Now go all the way to that far knob on the bottom and turn it out of that. So you're in a very strong oscillation. There we go. You got
it.
That's the idea.
Problem is remembering how I got it.
Yeah, it's the combination of controls and pretty much the two middle controls on the bottom that they have most effect at their extreme ends. That's where I've noticed it. And then keep that large one with the gold on it on the bottom right, not all the way to one side, or it'll tend to just make a solid tone. It sounds like you're starting to discover where the good spots are.
Yeah, a little bit. So the upper knob right next to the red on-off switch is the disc volume, right?
The knob next to the on-off switch is the volume. If you can't control the volume, that means you've got it in the wrong output. But if you're controlling it, it's just like you always do.
Okay.
Now, there's another thing I want you to know about. Are you able to hear me clearly now?
Yes, I can hear you clearly.
That battery pack, I sure don't like it. See where the battery pack sticks up over the top of the cabinet?
Yep.
It's near a little piece of tape that has a plus sign on it, and where the red and black wire kind of go around.
Yep.
Can you see under there, without moving that wire very much, there's a switch there.
Yes, I
see. Do not turn that switch the other way or the unit will go off. That's another on-off switch.
Okay.
I couldn't avoid that. All these battery packs have that switch. That's why I had to mount it that way.
Okay.
Tell me if you can see that switch.
Yes, I can see it.
It's hard to see.
I can see it. I've already seen it.
All right. Don't change its position. Leave it on, because that'll override your red on and off button, or your on and off switch, I mean.
Right. Now, let me tell you, the one bad thing about having the battery case is, sometimes in the old one, when I used to turn it on, and it would be stalled, you know, I couldn't get any sound out of it, and I'd turn all the knobs, and I couldn't get it started, you know? But if I took my finger and sort of ran it across the four batteries in the battery holder and spun them, somehow that made connections, made it connect.
Well, now that the connections are good, you shouldn't have to do that anymore.
Well, I just turned it on tonight and it didn't start.
That shouldn't be a problem
anymore. It didn't start tonight.
The problem is...
I'm saying it didn't start tonight.
Well, you need to make sure those knobs are in the proper position. Do not take that battery pack apart unless you absolutely have to.
I will.
It's very fragile, and I'm sorry about that.
But I'm just saying that was one way I used to get it started.
Yeah, I understand. Now, the thing is, if you ever do take that, well, obviously you will be taking that battery pack apart. Don't lose that little Phillips head screw. You know, there's a little screw that holds it on. It doesn't actually hold it, but it keeps it secure.
Yeah, okay.
When you undo that, the batteries will be exposed. You pull that little black thing straight up, and you'll see the batteries. Remember, the negative side always goes on the little spring. And unfortunately, one of those springs already broke, even though it's a brand new one. I managed to put it back in, but I'm afraid it might pop out again. If it does, the battery won't stay in. So you've got to be very careful when you change batteries.
Okay.
You know, that was so flaky. When I took the batteries out to test it one time, I all of a sudden looked around and there was a little spring stuck in my beard. It made me mad because that was a brand new battery pack. It's the one in the, it's the spring in the middle of the battery pack. It actually would be the one closest to that plus sign if you were looking at it. That's the one that might pop out again. So
okay.
Be very careful, please.
I won't be taking that apart for quite a while. You know what? I never can remember replacing the batteries on the old one ever in the whole time I had it. It just kept...
thing I designed into the pooper. It runs at an extremely low current.
It just keeps
going. You know, when I first made the thing, I made it so that it was... I made it so it would sound like malfunctioning electronic equipment from the 1960s. Because that's the heart of the pooper. It's a transistor radio amplifier. And I think it was probably came out in 1963. So it sounds like it's malfunctioning, but I have a lot of resistance, so the thing can oscillate, and it can sound like it's destroying itself, but it never will, because it never overheats or draws a lot of current. That's why the batteries last so long.
Okay, well, you've done an amazing job, and I will have to play with it for a while to get used to the booper's new nature. But thank you very much, and you'll be hearing it from now on.
One thing I wanted to tell you that you could try if you were a little more geeky.
Well, I'm a little more geeky.
If you got a wire, but the thing is, I would recommend that it was a volume control as well, and that output plugged it into that RCA plug on top with a control. You have another loop of feedback, and it can get very interesting. You could actually do that if you had the right stuff. You know, maybe I ought to make you one and send it to you so you could try that.
Maybe you should. I have never played with that, the input end of it very much at all. Even in a long time I've had it, I've never played much with that. So maybe I should at this point.
Well, at this point, probably best to be safe, because it's sounding pretty good what you're doing. But, you know, I used to actually run that old rhythm machine through it, and coming up on my website, I'm going to show everyone how we used to use the rhythm machine. The original Mini Pops Jr., I actually got it working again, and I got it controlling the booper. I've got it on tape, and I've got maybe 20 minutes of me fiddling around with it. You'll see my red hand coming into the picture, turning knobs and changing the beat on the rhythm machine. I almost started going into CP State, but that's another thing altogether.
All right, I gotta go. So I think we.
All right, well, I'll probably listen for a while, and if you run into trouble, let me know. I'll probably stay with it for a good hour or more, and we'll see how things go.
Okay.
And we should talk on the phone sometime, too, off the air. I can tell you a little more, because this is kind of confusing, and I apologize for any of the confusion.
That's fine. I think I've got it, and now I've got it.
Sounding great. Have fun, and I'll be listening. I'll see you later, then.
Thank you. Thank you. Talk to you later.
All right. Good night.
It's about that sex song. They're running these CB radios under everything. Oh, that's his CD. He did that. He does that. No one else does that. Now I can't get the effects going. Not punched in. All right. All right. Now, here's the booklet with effects, and I shall do a short solo to show you some of the perimeters and boundaries of sound from the booklet. 5-hour Over the Edge tonight, and it's called Guitars in Space. Universe, Part 77.
Blue out. this purple Japanese guitar. The priest said, God wants goodness, God wants light, God wants mayhem, God wants clean fight.
Music.
Circuit.
God wants peace, God wants war, God wants famine, God wants change to us. God wants sedition, God wants sex, God wants freedom, God wants sentence.
Rolling to 51.
Don't look so afraid. I'm only joking. The alien comic lies. The tickets in Haiti took the feather from its hook. The monkey at the corner wrote the joke down in his book.
You've been waiting for.
God wants borders, God wants crack, God wants rainfall, and God wants wood pigs.
Wake up time.
God wants Google, God wants shrines, God wants law, God wants organized crime, God wants crusade, God wants Japan, God wants good.
You should just be talking into consciousness now, and you just want to keep still while you warm up. Assuming the system doesn't cut in on us, it ought to take about 3 minutes from now. Should be running some figures now on the vitals.
Free bat rides every day. Howdy, friends. I'm Lord Jim Crabbington for Medieval Motors, your friendly truck stop of transportation in the Diet of Worms. Friends, whether you're in the body or out for lunch, we've got the Griffin, the Minotaur, or the sporty little camel leopard to suit your imaginary travel needs. And gosh, what can I say about these little guys? Yes, it's your all-new cardboard vampirettes, the economy transport that's got them all guessing on the other side. Well, we've got continents and peninsulas of new and used transfigurations and a sacred rose garden of perfect values. So get your ass in gear and your oxen in here so as we can trade indulgences and get you on your path. Now, we're just a painful mile off the freeway of Lost Hope at the intersection of down and out avenues in the Citadel of the Angel.
Al, how you doing? A lot of the good old boys are here tonight. We'd like to welcome you down to the television mission. Don't forget, if all you can do is sit at home, then try to keep yourselves awake and dial the phone.
He sat on a pile of stone. He stared at the broken bone in his head. Strains of a Viennese quartet rang out across the land. Thought to himself, memory is a stranger, History is for fools. And he cleaned his hands in a pool of holy writing. Turned his back on the garden and set out for the nearest town.
Hold on, hold on, soldier.
Radio 1.
System. Hello, Mark. You are okay.
There's an ounce of gold.
Punch up.
And the Germans kill the Jews, and the Jews kill the Arabs, and the Arabs kill the hostages, and that is the news. And is it any wonder that the monkey's confused?
BMF.
He says, Mama, the president's a fool.
Basic manual function.
Why do I have to keep reading these technical
You
methods?
Are okay, Mark.
And the joint is a step. On Wall Street said, don't make us laugh, you're a smart kid. Time is linear, memories are strange. History's for fools. Man is a tool in the hands of the great God Almighty. And they gave him command of a nuclear submarine. Sent him back, search of the Garden of Eden.
Do not voice operate.
System,
please. You are not in control.
It all makes perfect sense.
One, take 52.
Happy New Year, Mark. This is Angela, and we're going to let you wake up to some really schmoozy programming. Let's do a memory check. Hi, Beth. Don't worry about being groggy. I know you'll be doing just fine.
Oh!
This is KPFA and KPFD in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, KPFA.org online. Over the Edge brings you Universe Part 77 tonight, Guitars in Space.
Call in for pledges, yes. We have a lot of our special beauties answering the phones this evening. And the best thing you can do is dial this number that you see on your screen as quickly as you can with a contribution to the television mission. Don't forget to call in a pledge.
Talk about Jesus.
Talk about Jesus? Yeah. Well, you never know who's going to be here this evening. Yes, well, it's one. I know you are, son. I know it's one of the real positive qualities of the television mission is we just never know who's going to drop by. I mean, it's a lot of folks have been. The band is here. The band is getting set up. The band is ready. The band is ready. And I'm here to tell you that it's time, ladies and gentlemen.
In the last powerful days of another way of life, when everything happened in cars, when sullen, desperate men would do anything for a tankful, in the troubled years of the 100-year gas war and the terrible food insurrection, when armies mixed mustard and gas and relished war, in those frightened times, private citizens often had to do the terrifying work of real police, apprehending criminals and solving tricky moral problems. They had private eyes, but public fists, full tanks, but clean consciences. And tonight's story is only typical.
Car Hook, starring Dirk Yogurt as Dick Private, Private Dick. Tonight's chilling story, Roller Maidens from Outer Space.
Saturday morning. I just locked myself out of the office for a cool weekend that promised to be gin-soaked and hand-rubbed. At least that's what I figured she'd meant when she said, let's get drunk and refinish my furniture. Anyway, it was the way she said it, you know. Real husky, like a lead dog in a snow job. And I wasn't about to be left out in the cold. Damnation. Ah, well, I figured it wouldn't hurt just to answer it. A private Seamus is always hungry. I hadn't been exactly flush, and this might just be the ace in the closet that put some pizza in the pantry. Go ahead, something said to me. Answer it, she'll wait. So I did.
Ah, yes, the booper is back. It almost sounds like a bunch of bees in a deflating balloon that was swallowed by a puppy. That was swallowed by a sea lion, swallowed somehow by an overgrown platypus, that reached out with an electric drill and touched the live wire while being spaghettified into a black hole. That's what the booper sounds like to me, but I wanted to tell the weatherman, obviously, I'm one of his biggest fans, and I have many a cassette tape from the early 90s over the edge, and I just wanted to tell him, you must kill your boss. I hate it.
Yes, doesn't it seem strange that if you talked about this spooky action at a distance, wouldn't that be the spookiest action at a distance of all? I commit an act, a cue to God, here in my apartment, if some terrible thing happens, but the entire cosmos is replicated in some new bubble. That's really spooky action at a distance.
It is.
The whole history of the universe fractures into two splits. I mean, there are these discussions, but this is something that I myself find, you know, unpalatable.
Weren't just discovering building blocks of matter, leaving string theory in the dust. Physicists made a startling and strange prediction that the forces of nature can also be explained by particles.
holding the edge of these in more ways than one. Dick Private, Private Detective.
Mr. Private.
That's right, pal.
My name is Regular Boynton. My wife, Ethel, and I have been opposite you for many years on another network.
Oh, yeah. The Ethel and Regular show. I've heard of you. What's the matter? Swallow your car keys?
No.
Lock yourself out of the house?
No.
Want to know how to make an attractive bookend out of a shoebox and a brick?
No. Nothing that exciting, but look, you gotta get over here.
Well,
right away. You're just a couple of channels away. You can make
Nobody ever made it before.
No, come on, it's really weird over here.
Well, it ain't no Swiss picnic over here, pal.
But you don't understand. It's terrifying. Nothing is normal.
Well,
we all seem to be dreaming the same dream.
Well. I've got a funny one for you. Channel 001. Who does Dewey Duck?
Huh?
System in your audio out. Repeat. System
what?
Indicate
failure.
Difficulty.
Failure
in
light drain battery.
Repeat.
Count.
Ding. Please.
Testing 4. Testing 5.
Good morning.
Dewey was Donald's nephew. At least that's what he and Daisy claimed. And if anybody's listening down there, I've got a terrible backache here.
That's right, Mark. Now, on the red channel, read the system your vitals.
Mark. Mark T. Captain. Signs of life. Green. Elapsed time of sleep in 24-hour units. 3, 4, 3, 2.
And I'm mighty glad to be awake, too.
There's
terrific.
All these strange balls of light in our neighborhood, and...
Hold it.
Glad to.
Now hold it up to the light.
Okay.
He was right. This was serious. Light. Too much light. More light than I'd ever seen. It seemed impossible and just too easy that this amiable sip had discovered what we'd all been looking for years. The drain, the big leak, the place where it all goes in and doesn't have to come out. Listen, Boynton.
Oh, yeah?
Stay where you are. Too much power means trouble. And trouble is my problem.
What?
Hello, dear little
friend. Hello, dear little friend. Aren't we enjoying your movie? Aren't we really having a terrific time?
That's right.
I'm Nick Exxon. Owner, gentleman, President of the United States Motors, formerly Jailbird Motors. Have the used automobile pickup, or perhaps like a younger girl, big teeth like these. Wonderful examples. Here's 7-4 squat devil, grill, final dirt machine. Here's Elgin 7-4 fruit pan, fan, 80 capital of the world. Here's another one. Another one. Hundreds of them. We've got hundreds of 74 fruit bats. We're loaded down, pregnant, fine automobiles, and none of these cars is stolen, friend. Kind of service.
And then there are two branches where one thing happened and another thing happened. So that's not the most satisfying resolution to my mind. But what is an interesting resolution is, and it's really difficult to kind of stomach, is the possibility that I'm not free to make every choice that I think I'm free to make, and that I can only make choices that are compatible in some sense with the laws of physics.
Now, this is a really weird idea, but it's kind of like a game of tax in which the player, like me, and me are particles of matter.
And the ball we're throwing back and forth is a particle of force. It's called a messenger particle.
For example, in the case of magnetism, the electromagnetic force, this ball would be a photon. The more of these messenger particles or photons that are exchanged between us, the stronger the magnetic attraction.
Scientists predicted that it's this exchange of messenger particles that creates what we feel as force.
Experiments confirm these predictions with the discovery of the messenger particles for electromagnetism, the strong force, and the weak force.
In 1927, Clinton Davison and Lester Germer fired a beam of electrons, particulate entities without any apparent connection to waves, at a piece of nickel crystal. The details need not concern us, but what does matter is that this experiment is equivalent to firing a beam of electrons at a barrier with two slits. When the experimenters allowed the electrons that passed through the slits to travel onward to a phosphor screen where their impact location was recorded by a tiny flash, they had shown that the beam of particulate electrons must, unexpectedly, be some kind of wave.
The crucial thing about dark matter is it doesn't just explain one phenomenon. It doesn't just explain spinning galaxies, or it doesn't just explain the universe being held together, or the bullet cluster is behaving in a certain way, or the early universe collapsing into the Bonnet filament. It explains very, very many different things, and that's a really crucial aspect of dark matter.
We see the universe obeying a set of rules, and these rules are basically physics. Gravity, electricity, magnetism, that sort of thing. And you can ask yourself, how did those rules get into place?
And now, back to Brock. Bell, are you ready to Brock?
That's right, Brock Bell here on Cool AM 1680 The Heat. Let's cap some highs and whip some opinions into shape. We got early in Dougal County. You're on the heat seat. What's capping your highs, friend? Yes, sir, Colin.
Is it me on the radio now?
Yes, you are, Colin. Go ahead.
I might have not, sir. I mean, did I get them Randy Travis tickets?
Sir, the Randy Travis ganza was 2 weeks ago. Could you please just state your business?
I want to say that the problem with the economy is there ain't no damn jobs. I mean, I've been out of work since Friday at 5 o'clock, and I'm going back to work Monday, but I ain't gonna like it,
sir. That's called the weekend, and I know you're probably still balls deep in the middle of it, but it's actually Tuesday for the rest of us.
Look, I can't collect my unemployment thanks to big government bureaucrats who have taped up.
Well, something in the universe itself formed these rules. Or you might argue, well, maybe God formed these rules. But
somehow, even though individual electrons are tiny particles of matter,
you can say, well, then what formed God?
Each and every one also embodies a wave-like character.
And the sort of the usual religious answer is, God has always existed.
Listen, I can remember it.
Adam Sanders, we'll be seeing you in just a little while.
If an individual electron is also a wave, what is it that is waving? In 1927, Max Born put forward a suggestion that turned out to be the decisive step that forced physics to enter a radically new realm. The wave, Born proposed, is a probability wave.
And why it's become so widely accepted is that scientifically it's really important that any sort of explanation that you invoke explains more than it is intrinsically complex. So dark matter explains lots of different phenomena altogether.
And then say, well, then why not just say the same thing about the universe? There was something before the universe, if you can even make sense of that statement. And so you can argue back and forth over whether there is an intelligence guiding the universe or not. I don't see direct evidence for that.
Photosynthesis is the great liberator of biology. With photosynthesis, the energy is coming from the sun, and life could spread literally over the entire planetary surface.
And this remote corner of Western Australia holds clues to how that happened.
To understand what this means, picture a snapshot of a water wave that shows regions of high intensity near the peaks and troughs, and regions of low intensity near the flatter transition regions between peaks and troughs. The higher the intensity, the greater the potential the water wave has for exerting force on nearby ships or on coastline structures. The probability waves envisioned by Born also have regions of high and low intensity, but the meaning he ascribed to these wave shapes was unexpected.
These domed structures, called stromatolites, are built up layer by layer over thousands of years by tiny microbes.
I'll put it that way.
These microbes may be similar to life forms that dominated our planet billions of years earlier.
And so I'm not going to say there's no God. I'm not going to say there is a God. What I can say, and this really is not a cop-out. A lot of people say it is, but I don't think it is. What I can say is, All we can really do is observe the universe the way it is.
Really, dear? Gee, I'm so hungry I could eat a horse. What's for breakfast?
Horse pie and a short stack. Oh, would you rather have horse and eggs?
fell like rain.
Regular. Good morning, Ethel.
Tell me quick, did you call the detective?
I sure did. He's on his way now, but I don't know. I've never heard of anyone making it across two channels before.
Well, he's got to. It was so bad last night. Oh. There was glowing lizards whizzing around our apartment all night.
No.
And those horrible flaming spiders.
God.
Did you and Ethel see them?
Oh, sure. Now, Horny said that the Mertzes saw their whole lives pass across their bedroom wall like oil on velvet.
Oh, that's hideous. Yeah. Wow, everyone is so scared. I heard coming over here that all the announcers had quit and moved, and there's nobody to introduce us anymore.
Why are we whispering?
They're not taking...
All the women are getting really strange. I was going to tell you last night, Hussey and Betty Armstrong said I was going to stay up all night. All they started drinking wine and listening to old Louis Prima records, so by the time the lights came whistling around, they was freaked out, I want to tell you. Then my brother came to stay with us, and he isn't no favorite of Hussey's boy.
You know, you're right. The women are all acting
weird.
Weird, and Ethel's been moaning mysteriously and spending a lot of time in the bathroom.
Wow.
You know, Tricky, I think it all has something to do with their lodge, or whatever they call it.
Oh, boy, you could be right. The Dump Club boy, the mystic Aurora maidens from outer space lodge.
Well, I do admit they look pretty funny in those get-ups. But just because Tricky and then David and little Tricky and Beaver and all the other little ones grew up. And that's why they've got to have their stupid...
Wait a minute. What's that stupid what?
Stupid. Regular Bartlett, shut your trap shut.
Oh. It just so happens that we are going to solve this crazy mystery, right, Ethel?
Uh-huh.
Well, you two are certainly crazy enough.
Tricky Retardo, you make me so mad.
You two men sit around and don't do anything.
So we girls are going to take over.
That's the definite truth. Regular Bartlett, your ass is great.
Oh, dear.
Well, it was going to be a secret, but... I guess we better tell you before you run out making fools of yourselves.
What? He's, right, really, dear. It just so happens that we've,
hired
a famous detective from another channel.
Oh, yeah?
Who?
Deke Private.
That's it? Oh. Come on, Ethel. Oh, these two dumb buddies will never get anything done. Oh, and speaking of rabbits, Tricky, I want your lazy brother to hop right out of our apartment.
Oh, but, honey.
I want that bum out.
He's my brother.
I don't care if his name is Jesus Retardo.
Honey, his name is Jesus Retardo.
Well, I'm going to put a stop to him and you and these holy ghosts with the combined power of mystic womanhood.
Oh, yeah.
So long.
Oh, who's he?
Oh, wait, girls. Oh, gosh. I'm afraid we've done it now. Where do you think they're going?
Oh, just to their lodge meeting. They're just going to go out to the Dark Winter Motel, knock back a few pink ladies, and talk big like they do every Saturday.
Except you got to admit that this Saturday is a little different.
Well, I just don't know what we're going to do. You know, Mr. Conklin saw glowing spiders in his rose garden. And what about the night we all dreamed the same dream?
Oh, what a dream, too. Wow, what a bunch of tomatoes, right?
Hey, Tricky. Tricky.
In here.
Oh, hey, regular man, how you been?
Oh!
Hey, Tricky.
Jesus, fine, just fine.
Hey, brother, I was just remembering with Regular here, that dream I told you about, the one everyone had all at the same time. You know, all those real sharp chicks, and like it was on the moon or something.
Oh, I remember you told me. Hey, regular man, you got anything to smoke?
Oh, well, maybe there's something hidden in the boy's bedroom. I'll see.
Good.
Hey, speaking of sharp chicks, who was that babe that drove you up in that big Cadillac last night, huh?
Chicken, I don't know, man. She picked me up out in the desert yesterday.
Man, she looked just like the girls in that dream. Oh, boy, the things they were doing to me. Oh, the things they were doing to each other.
Oh, yeah. Here's some of this funny smelling. I think this is the Jamaican that David thought he had hid from me.
Oh, yeah. Oh. I remember the stuff. The kids were smoking this the year they disappeared to high school.
Oh, good weed, man. Listen, what is happening around here anyway? I've been gone for a long time. The chicks seem real hostile.
Well, it's this club they're all in, the Roly Maidens. Uh-huh. We don't know what it means.
Yeah, but it's not just the club. You can tell they're really, really scared by these lights and dreams. Man, the way they're acting about you, it's just you think it was the cause of it all.
Me?
Yeah.
I can't help it if there's strange things always happen when I'm around, can I? Hey, didn't you call that detective?
Oh, yeah, but he's a couple of channels away. It may take him some time to get here.
I got an idea. Let's turn on the TV. Maybe we can find him before he finds us.
USA Anakin fits me.
There he is.
I got him.
Isn't that him? That hat. I
think. The sunset blazed down Main Street like the birds smoking on 8 fast bars of Triple Moon, the Smoky Club on Broadway, or maybe the pit off 52nd anywhere, so long as it wasn't here in this little jerkwater town.
Jerkwater
that
town?
That reminded me. Jerk Waters, that yo-yo. He had the tip-off that Johnny Fresno was out of the can and holed up in Smallburg with the bread the feds hadn't found from the little bake-off Fresno and his boys pulled in Gotham just before Johnny started singing his jailhouse rocks off, remember? Well, here I was anyway, me, Dick Private, Private Dick, the smartest cookie in Horse Alley, looking up and down Hicks
Street. Hey, that looks like your
taxi.
Car, Regular.
Hi, Slim. So why don't you get in?
Wow. Ruby lips, shapely hips when she walked across the street. I'll bet you all the cats flipped. What was her game? Strip poker and everything wild? That reminded me of strip poker.
She
warned me that Johnny Fresno liked his women rough, but this one was making my hard part soft. Her heavily rouged nipples thrust like highball glasses through a persimmon sweater that looked like a heavyweight watermelon bout. Her waist was unusually small and laced tight with string cheese. There's my first clue, I thought. String cheese, Fresno, Armenians. You see, it all started to add up at the counter, but those twin bulges wouldn't let me check out so soon.
Say, Lips, you better stop talking to yourself and get in, or maybe we'll see if your ride is any match for this one.
No!
It wasn't. I was staring down the barrel at 3.45s, and then one in the middle looked hungry.
What a ride!
I got in slowly like a hipster at a funeral, and she burned some rubber. Her breasts swelled, and she put the cheeks to her heels.
You know, I've written 100 scary books,
commercial.
But I still like to pick my dinner up right off the ground.
Oh, this guy.
That's right. I'm Gilbert Skink.
Yes, yes.
And did you know that poison oak makes an excellent tea?
Come on.
Ever eat
a pussycat? What happened?
Well, when I come home to write up more horror stories of your food, I want to help the natural way to make a little money.
Just change it.
I like you.
Oh, this isn't it.
No matter what you do.
What's down there in the corner? What's back there?
Well, hasn't today been the nicest sort of day for me? Yeah. Yes, it has. Hasn't it? Well, now, I guess I'll drag this home and kill it and eat it in my real house.
No, turn it quick. Quick, turn it. Turn it. Turn it.
The size of a wave at a given point in space is proportional to the probability that the electron is located at that point in space.
And in the arid hills nearby, there may be evidence of these ancient creatures. These rocks have remained unchanged for 3.5 billion years. Here, it's possible to walk on the surface of early Earth. Martin Van Cronendonk spends months at a time in this wilderness studying the geology and producing maps.
As the laws of physics say that I was born and I went back in time, I'm not going to be able to change that history.
Discovered particles, scientists were closing in on Einstein's dream of unifying the forces. Particle physicists reasoned that if we rewind the cosmic film to the moment just after the Big Bang, some 14 billion years ago, when the universe was trillions of degrees hotter, the messenger particles for electromagnetism and the weak force would have been indistinguishable.
Trying to discern the rules the universe works by, whether it's quantum mechanics and statistics or relativity or whatever, and try to understand those and within the framework of science. And at some point, if you get to the point where science says we've explained all this stuff, but there's still this one mystery, you can start arguing there whether God exists there. But there are philosophical problems with that as well. You can talk about God of the gaps and all that kind of stuff, where God is just what science doesn't understand. But the problem with that is the more science understands, the less room there is for God.
Places where the probability wave is large are locations where the electron is most likely to be found.
But I prefer to just examine reality with the tools we have, try to figure it out from there and see where that takes us.
Just Christopher Hitchens came to me in a dream wearing the Holy Man Batman's cowl. And he was smoking a pipe. And he told me that Islam is nothing but Boba Fett shooting himself in the face.
What happened to start the Big Bang?
I'm really worried about my goldfish. I don't think he sleeps. His eyes are always, always open. Is my goldfish getting any sleep?
No. Yeah. Open.
Yeah.
You wanna taste the delay?
There's a length of time.
Like a wave of time.
Smaller than which you cannot know anything.
You wanna taste?
As long as he's not floating, I wouldn't worry about that goldfish. And I'm glad that somebody else reported the echo, and I don't have it right now. So it is not only unlocalized, it is intermittent.
It's called plankton, and it has to do with quantum mechanics.
It is thus.
And when the universe was younger than that age, according to quantum mechanics, we can literally not know anything about it.
That's correct. No information can be transmitted between that partition of creation and us.
And so, you know, what does that mean? I mean, that is so mind-bending. I don't understand it. I don't think anybody really truly grasps what that means.
Well, it means that there are some things that are forever inaccessible to us by their very nature.
And so, what could have happened before that? Does it even have... Can you even ask, what was time like before time was even beginning?
Well, one could take a simplified philosophical tack that whatever happened before was a variation of what we are going through, like incarnations in a grand scale.
You know, these are weird questions. And so that would be probably my number one. But I think my number two that we... just barely be edged out by that is dark energy real, and what is it?
Yeah, it's apparently out there, but being dark, it's tough to get a handle on it observationally, but we're doing it. We're steadily working out what needs to happen because we're smart.
And what are its implications for the future of the universe? I think that would be a big one.
We can't. I agree, sir. The government is out of control, but it sounds like you are too, buddy. You can go ahead and pick those drawers off the floor. You just got opinion with
it. Well, there is this theory that there are other dimensions, maybe even 11 dimensions, and we're only conscious of four of them, three of space and one of time.
Dark energy is a bunch of Chicanos in Fresno, in the dark, eating Denny's after playing soccer, after playing Halo 3.
And this might explain why gravity is so weak. We know of four fundamental forces. Gravity is just one of them. The gravity is by far the weakest of them. And there's this idea that in these other higher dimensions, gravity is much stronger.
If the universe followed the rules of classical mechanics or of physics, then the goldfish would have no real free will. But if it followed the rules of quantum mechanics, it also wouldn't have any free will. It would just be like the random roll of the dice that Einstein believed God didn't play with.
Yes, you have to remind us that this is the universe, but 77 guitars in space. What about the guitars, man? Hey? Give us some guitars, please.
Hi, yes. Thank you for reminding me. You are listening to a radio show. It's called Over the Edge, brought to you by Negative Land. And tonight, it's Universe Part 77, Guitars in Space. And since we just had a request for one, some. Here they are.
Thank you. Jim. How could you treat me this way? Hey, how'd you treat me this way? Aw, Jim. Hey, honey, how could you treat me this way? Hey, how'd you treat me this way? You know you broke my heart ever since you went away. Now you said that you loved us, but you only made love to one of us. Jim, how could you treat me this way? You know you broke my heart ever since you went away. When you look into the eyes of hate, oh, 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 oh. Looking through the eyes of hate, whoa, 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 whoa. When you look into the eyes of hate, when you look into the eyes of hate, yeah, whoa, whoa, whoa. When you look into the eyes of hate, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. When you look into the eyes of hate, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa.
Oxygen. Anybody hurt?
No, nothing serious.
Just shaken. What happened?
We've either been rammed or we've been shot up.
The same as Orbiter 1?
Yes.
So that spot on the radar screen was...
Yes, an unidentified flying object.
Entertainment delay.
Check your
audio.
Again, please.
Testing, testing.
Testing, this sounds real bad,
system. Can you plug the drain?
No.
I'm out of communication.
You are
out.
I'm out of communication.
Failure. Failure.
Not a difficulty.
Landing phase.
A-OK.
Rolling tape.
53.
Over the edge.
Thank you. Thank you.
Standing at the window, a farmer's wife in Oxfordshire glances at the clock. It's nearly time for tea. She doesn't see the phantom in the hedgerow dip its wing. Doesn't hear the engine sing. But in the cockpit's techno glow behind the Ray-Ban shine, a kid from Cleveland in the comfort of routine scans his dials and smiles, secure in the beauty of military life. There is no right, no wrong, only tin cans and cordae, and white cliffs and blue skies and flight. Flight. Flight.
To be 9 planets, but there are now 90 planets. You know, the ultimate state of the universe is so dark and mysterious that it generates butterflies in my stomach, and that creates the tickles in my spine, and that creates goose pimples, and that penetrates my mind, and then the whole Big Bang goes.
Places where the probability wave is small are locations where the electron is unlikely to be found.
And just in our dimensions, we only see sort of a shadow of it. And if you could somehow perceive all 11 of these dimensions, all these forces would be balanced. I have no clue if this is even if it makes any sense or not.
Many people find dark matter's existence very mysterious and ask how it can possibly be that most matter, about five times the amount we see, is something we can't detect with conventional telescopes. Some are even suspicious that dark matter is really some sort of mistake. Personally, I think quite the opposite, though admittedly not everyone sees it this way. It would perhaps be even more mysterious if the matter we can see with our eyes is all the matter that exists. Why should we have perfect senses that can directly perceive everything?
It's the best, and it really works as a very coherent picture as a whole. Because it explains lots of things, people are generally widely accepted. I mean, of course, you know, when it was first introduced and explaining one thing away, then everybody was skeptical. You know, why would you invent something, some mysterious new substance that's invisible? And, yeah, right, of course. Nobody believed that, yeah. Well, as time's gone, it seems that lots and lots and lots of different phenomena have been explained by this dark matter, and that is why scientists are now widely believing that the mysterious and unbelievable as it is, it really is the best explanation for all these different stories.
Again, the lesson of physics over the centuries is how much is hidden from view. From this perspective, it's mysterious why the stuff we do know should constitute even as much as 4% of the energy density of the universe, an apparent coincidence that my colleagues and I are currently trying to understand.
The beauty of military life, no questions, only orders of flight. We'll be right back.
places where the probability wave is zero are locations where the electron will not be found.
You're worried about the energies created in this particle accelerator that we're smashing things together at very high speed and creating dark matter, all sorts of things, even potentially very small black holes. But Mother Nature has already done this experiment. There are high energy particles whizzing around the universe and in fact slamming into the Earth's atmosphere every day, all the time. And we've already seen that these things have much higher energies than we're going to be able to create in this new particle accelerator, and that they don't create anything that's going to gobble the Earth. Fortunately, if they create dark matter, then it doesn't interact in any way, just goes away.
If you take an asteroid a few miles across, and you drop it very near the Earth, such that it passes within a few thousand miles of the Earth's surface, the gravity of that asteroid will tug on the Earth, and if you set this up just right, it can actually move the Earth out a little bit from the Sun, just a few miles. But if you do this over and over and over again, every 6,000 years, I'd have to look that up. But you can do this and gently and gradually move the Earth farther out from the Sun. Now, right now, the Sun is heating up. It's not much. But over the course of 100 million years, the Sun will heat up enough that quickly. You don't want the Sun heating up 1,000 degrees because that will heat up the Earth several tens of degrees and cause a runaway greenhouse effect. So if you very slowly move the Earth out from the Sun, this asteroid passes by the Earth. If you're clever, you make it pass by Jupiter and Saturn. And you're sort of stealing energy from them and giving it to the Earth and moving the Earth farther out from the Sun. And this will work.
trillion and change into the total entertainment combat video game. And up here in the stands, the fans go wild. The cheerleaders flip when you wiggle your hip. Though we all like to bet when you take the jeans from the refrigerator and then the bag gets hit. Sticks to her skin like BB gun days when knives pierce autumn leaves. But that's okay, see the children bleed. It'll look great on the TV.
Entertainment closeout. Jim and Ellie House of Fire. Rolling. Anytime, Jim.
One, two, three.
Cruising down the rivers on a Sunday afternoon.
The years in your ears, mid-century to century 2000. This is an audio history of your first 50 years, Mark, prepared for your entertainment by the Graphophone Entertainment Group. In 1950, while you were born like so many others like you, this busy nation hung out a clean hand to the victims of the past and discovered the mouse-tongued enema of tomorrow. Primitive, black-and-white, single-system TWV obsessed the snowbound American family and you. Nobody wanted to remember anything, but they got you drop drip. Remember, Nellie?
Yes, Jim. They were the fabulous 50s, a lavish epoch of rhinestones and chrome set against the basic black of daily life. While your lucky mom drove a hard top and a dishwasher, Pop relaxed with a flat top and his choice of newspapers.
Wasn't that something? But you were too young then to be a juvenile delinquent, and not old enough to care by the time was up for the old Jim. Before you could help it, you were growing to adult manhood in the swinging 60s.
By 1960, color was an everyday necessity. That way, within a few short years, the once easy choice between mom and bad and good and dad had to be made in the marketplace of public confusion. Famous heroes came and went. Business improved.
Boy, did it. A few have a nice days afterwards in a wartime frenzy. Americans all over the world went to the moon and back. When the trip was out of sight, they thought they had nothing to show for it but some dirty pictures. And that was what most everybody wanted.
I'll say, Jim, nearing the end of your second decade, Mark, just when it seemed as if everything you had in mind was legal and life was one big suitcase, it was time to get tough again from the top down.
Bring us together. The sober 70s, soft on the inside, damage resistant on the outside. A hungry people learned to eat buffalo and crow, while its elected bureaucracy was retired to celebrate the revolution.
Folks young and old began to think more about their mobile homes now that they could watch the recreation of their choice on the new imported double screen. Many believed that God had come back. We all wore old clothes.
I'm still wearing them. And then after a long string of local fireworks, the first of the oil wars exploded. Business improved, public interest declined. The president needed a volunteer, Mark. You were it. And so the Pegasus leaped skyward that sultry spring morning in 1979.
You were only 30 when you left for Planet X. How old do you think you are now?
That's a question for the computers.
Back here, it was business as usual.
The Irish-Israeli crisis.
The near-tragic Latin American devaluation.
The Pacific energy conflict.
The pirate raids of 85 and 86.
Those something. And yet at home, things slowed down a lot. Eco-planning and life system improvement, together with the population stabilization program under President Bolt, created the North American Village Movement. By 1988, just as you were entering the orbit of Planet X, political life began to become a thing of the past.
Some called them the empty 80s, but now others are being naughty in the naked 90s. New words like Navshmavtapa,
Voltarama,
Tide Energy,
Zeppelin,
Simulaser,
Retirement Camp, and new ideas like
Poupang,
Equalism,
Divisibility,
Songhua Runshanyin,
new tourist nations like Amazonia and Namland.
And a few surprises, Mark. For instance, a new head in Rushmore National Park. And final elimination of the combustion engine. 2 years ahead of schedule.
Yes, it's nicer to be alive in 1995.
I'll say.
And it will be a flash to have you back. Sorry we haven't been able to bring you right up to date, but very soon now the Cape will be shut back, terminating the North American effort in space. Except, of course, for you.
That's right, Mark. And what a time you've missed. It's been entertaining to share it with you on The Years in Your Ears. This is Jim.
And Nellie Housefire saying,
so long until last time again.
This entertainment brought to you by GEG. Look for graphophone loop polos and magna players everywhere.
I remember rivers, Nelly.
You've been up to anywhere.
You got a big old mouth, son. You got yourself a big old body to pack up. Nothing to tell them.
Yeah, another telephone tough guy. I'm here every day, pal, 3 to 6.
Captain Hines on the fives. Front two.
Oh, hang on, Hans. We'll need
it. Okay, we're going to take a quick station break. Right, right. And when we come back, the ground zero miles. No or hell no.
You're listening to 2AM1685.
No one has ever directly seen a probability wave. And conventional quantum mechanical reasoning says that no one ever will. Instead, we use mathematical equations developed by Erwin Schrödinger, Niels Bohr, Werner Heisenberg, Paul Dirac, and others to figure out what the probability wave should look like in a given situation. We then test such theoretical calculations by comparing them with experimental results in the following way. After calculating the purported probability wave for the electron in a given experimental setup, we carry out identical versions of the experiment over and over again from scratch.
I mean, the physics of this is actually relatively simple. The really doing it would be really hard in practice, but it is possible to do it. And so as the sun heats up, we can in fact move the Earth out and maybe buy ourselves a few hundred million years doing this. You know, when the sun expands into a red giant, it's going to stay that way for a few million years, and then eventually it's going to collapse back down. And so we'll have to move the Earth in and out over and over again if we want to keep the Earth alive. What I'm hoping is that by then, you know, a billion years from now, we're not going to need the sun. We're not going to need the Earth. We'll find some other planet or we'll, you know, live inside of spaceships or whatever. I don't know. But I think it sure is fun to speculate on this kind of stuff and let it expand your mind a little bit. That keeps you in practice. I think it keeps you healthy.
Yeah, there's definitely something big there, and there's going to be something big in the unification of quantum theory with Einstein's theory of gravity, because those two things we can't seem to, at least in our pen and paper, make a mesh. They really don't seem to go together. And yet we know that very early in the universe's history, things must have been behaving quantum mechanically because of very high energies. We're probing really microscopic physics, particle physics, and it's also a theory of gravity because we're talking about the behavior of all of space-time and all the curves in space-time in response to this quantum phenomena. And yet we really, that whole picture of what happens when those two scales sort of compete is very foggy. And that's sort of the great hope, is that we'll have a way of understanding the universe when we understand how quantum mechanics and Einstein's theory of gravity go together. There's a huge pull with a theory called string theory, where you imagine that if you look at fundamental particles, that if you look very, very closely at these fundamental particles, you find out they're not point particles. maybe if I look very, very closely at an electron, it's not really a dot. It's really a little loop of string. And what makes it an electron is, in a sense, the note it's playing on that little loop of string. And if I look at all of the matter in the universe, they'd all be the same little loops of string playing different notes.
Although we don't exactly see it, we do detect dark matter's gravitational influence. We know dark matter exists due to the extensive observational evidence of its gravitational effects in the cosmos. The first clue that it existed came from the speed with which stars rotated in galaxy clusters. In 1933, Fritz Zwicky observed that galaxies in galaxy clusters orbited faster than could be accounted for by the visible mass, and Jan Oort soon after observed a similar phenomenon in the Milky Way. Zwicky was convinced enough by his work to conjecture the existence of dark matter that no one could directly see. But neither of these observations was conclusive. A faulty measurement or some other galaxy dynamics seemed like a far more plausible explanation than some invisible substance invented solely to provide additional gravitational attraction. At the time Zwicky made his measurements, he didn't have the resolution to see individual stars. Much more solid evidence for dark matter came from Vera Rubin, an observational astronomer who much later, in the late 1960s and early 1970s, made detailed quantitative measurements of stars rotating in galaxies.
Hi, this is Phil Austin from the Firesound Theater. I've got with me Peter Bergman. Peter, say hi.
Well, hi.
And
be
Phil,
here.
Phil Proctor, are you here?
No.
David, are you off mic here somewhere?
Yeah, I'm on the backside.
Okay, okay, give Neverland the...
Yeah, what are we listening to? It's the...
Not listening. KPFA, I believe, if they're still around.
Over the Edge again.
Yeah.
They can have that if they want.
This is the Firesign Theater, and we'd like to listen to Over the Edge
all the time when we're over the edge.
Not listening. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, you know what you did.
This is the Firesign Theater, and we like to listen to Over the Edge
when we're over the edge, which is often. KPFA, Over the Edge.
Natural as oil on water.
Come on. It's real sad like her.
Boyfriend's that yo-yo.
There he is.
He couldn't even imagine how much trouble he was in. And with me tied up down in this filthy cellar, there was no one to want him. I wasn't even sure by now what channel I was on. And it looked like
there he is, Johnny.